internet coverage in Germany, and that we provide faster internet to households and industries. And yeah, so therefore we need to really change the process and speed up all the planning work which is involved with that. Additionally, or which underlines this from a board member from Deutsche Telekom AG, Dirk Wessner, he stated in public in 2018 that with the beginning of 2021, we will provide FTTH, so fiber to the home, for up to 2 million per year. The project started mid of 2017, and one may say, okay, that's still a long time until 2021. But that's not really true, because if you would like to start building and do the construction work in 2021, all the planning has to be done in 2020, which again means that all the IT work and all the applications and the processes and tools, they must be ready by the end of this year. So there's not that much time, has not been that much time for the project and all the work we have done. So what are we doing? We identified actually certain areas where we can improve the planning process, and there are certain leverages and measurements which we took, and we need a lot of data in order to speed up the process and to automate a lot of things. We need 2D and even 3D data to do this, and I will come to this later with some more details. We are having problem with the existing data from Deutsche Telekom, so the existing fixed landline data in Deutsche Telekom needs correction and conflation. There's also Graham here in the audience who's working on that part. And yeah, one goal is to automate a lot of processes, so automated planning. And then we have two more. It's a simplified purchase process. I'm not covering this. And also a digital plan correction. So by the end, what was really built by the construction teams outside, this information has to come back again into the systems. As you can imagine, there's a lot of geo information and geo data involved in this, especially yeah, in the first three parts. And I'm going to focus on the 2D and 3D data collection, and also into the automated planning part. yeah, for doing this and for providing the data, and for yeah, also crunching and processing the data, we build up a spatial data infrastructure, which is yeah, coming from the description here, is doing more or less what you would expect from a spatial data infrastructure. So we're providing different kind of services. Of course, we have map services, we have search services, location services, and we're also providing different applications to the end user. So WebGIS applications, but also management and workflow, user interfaces. And of course, we're also providing data services and processing services. And again, I will focus on those two. So if we look at the data, what we are taking into this planning process, yeah, we're taking it from different sources. And one really very important point is that we are getting information about the surface types. So why do we need information from the different surfaces? There was also another talk already this morning by Markus Neteler, who explained a little bit more detailed about this. But we need the surfaces because we need to find, or would like to find, the cheapest possible ways for the trenches. So we would like to find the cheapest way where to put the optical cables. And in order to do so, we need to have the information from the surfaces. You can imagine that different surfaces, or depending on the surface type, different costs are involved when you would like to put the cable inside there. So of course, it's cheaper to put the cable in open land or in grass area than it is to do this on asphalt or concrete. So we're trying to detect the different surface types. On the one hand, you see on the left, We're doing this with terrestrial LiDAR data, which we are collecting by ourselves with so-called T-surface cars. We are collecting LiDAR data and panoramic pictures and also normal pictures. And from this, we're generating, by the use of an artificial neural network, different surface types. But the car, of course, is not running around everywhere, not in every single street and small streets. And to some extent, even the LiDAR cannot really record everything because there's shadow or there are parking cars and we don't get the information. So we need to supplement this information in order to get the surfaces for the whole area where we're going to do the planning for the fiber rollout. We're doing this by making use of aerial pictures, so digital autophotos, and which is again supplemented with LiDAR data when it's available in Germany. There are some federal states which have open data policies, and we're making use of this. And by making use of this, we're getting as well surfaces for the area. The information is not that detailed as we do get it from the surface cars or from the terrestrial LiDAR data, but it's good enough to fill the holes and to get the information. And we're then extracting by a rather complex process, which Markus Nitteler just explained this morning, to extract a topological line network with the potential trenches, so where potentially we can put the optical fiber cables. This is just again mentioning the talk from this morning. The original idea was that this talk would have been after this one, but this didn't work out. But of course, if you're interested, you can still watch it. So this is very simplified workflow, and to some extent also showing the different components which are involved into the process. So the first part, you see the incoming data. So on the one hand, the terrestrial LiDAR data from the T-surface car. We're having the autophotos, and we're having this artificial neural network where we are classifying the surface data and the pictures with, and also using Actinia to generate the surfaces from the digital autophotos. And it's a hybrid system. It's not only open source software which we're using. We are also making use of FME, feature manipulation engine. And in this case, or for this workflow, it's doing a lot of orchestration of all this workflow. So it's always triggering the different steps and getting the status from all the different processes here. So in the end, we're having classified surfaces. And then again, we're making use of Actinia for a different process to generate the potential trenches, which are in the end stored in the database. For the generation of the trenches, we have a really large set of rules. So for example, there are methodologies for the trenches which cannot be applied in urban areas, in cities. There are methodologies which need to have a certain length so that it makes sense to apply them. And there are a lot of more rules, rather complex rules. These are all handled during the process of generating the potential trenches. And we are also making use of cadastral data and OpenStreetMap data in order to get more information and to really apply those rules. So the first part, so from all what you see on the left to storing the data in the database, that's all automated. The only manual part actually is to upload the data from the surface car. And then once you can start the process and everything else is handled automatically, which is already a huge step forward. then we have the part with our user interfaces. We have different, as I said, WebGIS platforms, and we have management platforms. We also have a 3D client, which I will show you. And for this, we're making use of two frameworks. It's GeoOrchestra and Shogun. we're using here in order to provide interfaces to the users and provide services for other applications as well. So this is an example of the WebGIS and the linkage of a 2D and 3D application. So on the left side, you see a normal background map, and the dots are showing the positions where the surface card took images, so panorama pictures. And we have a linkage between the 2D and 3D or client. Client is actually showing here panorama pictures. It's, you can imagine it's like a Google Street View. You can move around in the pictures, and we're using this for the planning of the cabinets. So the gray cabinets you see on the side of the streets where we built, which we need to provide fiber to the home. So, and in the end here, this is the current status. You could say we're using pots to generate paper again. There's an output from paper, which is then going to the communities, because we need to get the approval for all the locations we have planned. That's, I hope, at least just an intermediate step. So we would like to get the communities either to work with our interfaces or to have at least a data exchange format where we can transfer the data directly. There are already discussions going on with for a pilot with the federal state of Hessen. So how are we working? I'm not going to explain all of this picture, would be a talk by itself. We're using the Open Telecom Cloud here, which is providing an OpenStack API. And as you can see, there are a lot of tools and processes going on which are not related to any geoprocessing and geodata handling at all. It's all about setting up our infrastructure. So the first part, at least, we're using GitLab. And infrastructure as code to create our VMs and to provision our VMs and to install the applications. And we're using a CI/CD chain to generate the images and to install the applications and in the cloud and to put the images into the pods of the OpenShift cluster. And of course, we also have monitoring in place using Grafana and for logging Kibana. This is a little bit more detail about the CI/CD chain. Most important part is that it's really separated between devs and ops. Although the people which are doing this, they're all working in a team, in our team. And as you can see, we have certain environments. We have a development environment, integration, staging, and production. And we need to bring all the code changes and the developments into the different environments. So the developer, once he checked his code in, the chain is starting to build the image, and we're doing automated unit tests as well before we build the image, and we then put the image into the Magenta Trusted Registry, which is just the telecom registry. We can compare it to the normal Docker registry. So this is work of the developer by itself to bring everything to the development environment. And at least that's our goal. Currently, we handle it a little bit differently. But the goal is that coming from this, the operations team is then bringing the same image to the different environments. So we can really be sure that the exact same status is reached in all the different environments. The workflow is more or less the same, but we're also running integration tests, also automated to some extent, to see if the applications are working correctly and are interacting correctly together. Yeah, of course, this is a really huge topic and a complex project, and we need a lot of people to work on this, and we can't handle it by ourselves at Telekom IT or Deutsche Telekom AG. There's also a lot of specific knowledge involved, which we need to get externally. And here you can see the companies which are all involved here. There are different parts from Deutsche Telekom, T-Systems, T-Systems Slovakia, some international team here, and also different companies, which some of them, Mundialis, Terrestris, Chemtocamp, they're also present during the Phosphor G. We're working in an agile mode. So we are applying Scrum and working in 2 weeks cycles in order to develop everything. And recently, starting last year, on top of this, we also implemented or make use of SAFe, which is Scaled Agile for Enterprises, which is producing some overhead, I would say, but on the other hand, it gives structure and helps us to move forward. There was also already a talk yesterday by Emanuel Belo from Chemtocamp, who explained a little bit about the way how we are interacting and how we're working together. So with this, I would like to thank you, and I'm happy to hear questions if there are any.